And now I'm very happy to introduce to you Bernd Paison, who is one of the GNU Forth maintainers and who's the principal developer of Net2O. It's an alternative network stack as an overlay on UDP, which is quite interesting, and he has a dream. He wants to create an alternative, he wants to fix the internet and wants to create alternative infrastructure, and so he will speak about the Cloudcalypse. Thanks so much, Bernd.
Okay. So, the Cloudcalypse is when the cloud collapses, and what do we do with the current cloud problems? We need a new internet. The old one is broken. And so I started building Net2O about 10 years ago, bottom up, and now I'm reaching the top level, which is social networks, chat, the layer that comes between the user and the machine. And that is a progress report, sort of, because I've done a number of presentations on Net2O in the past. So my motivation is, yes, the internet is a bad gateway, is broken in some ways. 6 years ago at Snowden gave us a lot of insight what happened, but we don't need the Americans, we don't even need the Europeans. We have even we in Germany can break the internet. There's a new law in discussion. Telemedia providers are equalized to ISPs. You know, the ISPs have to hand over their data to the secret services, and the telemedia providers, that is something like YouTube, like Facebook, like Twitter, and there's a discussion about handing out passwords or similar account credentials to allow them to log into your account, take all your data there and manipulate like they want it. It's an online search of cloud data, and they also still want backdoors, which the Americans say is reasonable encryption, and the security guy says it's completely unreasonable if you give backdoors. And so you have rotated topic of the month. 1 month it's terrorism, next month is child porn, and then it's protection of minors to force this agenda. So what do we have as progress? Well, alternatives, not just Net2O, become more usable, other alternatives also, but I'm talking about Net2O, so the alternatives can talk for themselves better than I can do. And Snowden wrote a book in which he also talks about social networks in the introduction. So he said, few of us understand it at that time, but none of the things that we'd go on to share would belong to us anymore. So it's belongs to the companies. The successor of e-commerce companies have said failed because they couldn't find anything we were interested in buying. Now had a new product to sell. That new product was us. So you are the product when you are on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, and you are not the customer. You're the product. You're sold. And our attention, our activities, our locations, our desire, everything about us that we revealed, knowingly or not, was being surveilled and sold in secret, so as to delay the inevitable feeling of violations that is, for most of us, coming only now. And this surveillance would go on to be actively encouraged and even funded by an army of governments greedy for the vast volume of intelligence they would gain. This has some libertarian framing you find often in the American and UK world. That is, if the corporates do something, is one thing, is not as evil as if the government does the same thing. But in fact, it really doesn't matter if the corporate takes your data and use it to sell you stupid things you don't need, you don't want, but they create the desire for you to buy a new iPhone every year or something like that. Or if I complain about SUVs in cities on Twitter, I get ads from companies which want to sell me SUVs. So, well, they want to sell us products we don't need, and the world is harmed by those products. It's not just the government is bad, it's also the companies are bad. So don't fall for this framing. It's not at that point when the government collects the data, which is the bad part. It's already bad when the companies collect it. So we have some problems with people as well. Last time I had this XKCD 386 as picture for what the companies want you to. They want to stay you online and engage in heated discussions to get more of the adverts they want to show you. But we also have a problem with people online, and this is the antithesis to the social network is the antisocial hate work. And why do people hate each other so much online? And we have this problem not on Twitter, we have this since Eternal September, which is September 1993, when AOL connected Usenet to the people who just bought these AOL CDs and put them in, with a cheap modem into their computer, and were no longer students of elite universities, but just normal people. And the reason is that opinions, when you talk about opinions, are not about facts, it's about values people believe. And people believe things is not something that is open up for discussion for people, that is their core values and their identity. And identity in discussion is vigorously defended. And it's used to segregate people. So people in different communities have different identities, use different things to show their identity. And if they clash on the internet, they have their wall in the head. They don't need the wall around their community. And it causes them to be aggressive against these other opinions. And we had this free speech concept from the 18th century, developed in a time where religion was strong and the communities were separated back at that time. So this free speech was about the state not intervening. So the communities themselves had a homogeneous opinion, a homogeneous belief. And instead of having the head of state say what kind of religion you choose, your community choose yourself, and the state doesn't engage. That is the free speech of that time, and helped coexistence of different beliefs, but separated. And it also helped the people who did scientific research to do that against the dogmas of the church. But now we have communication between all these groups, and we're no longer segregated. So we have to find a way around this, and this is a social problem. It's not just the commerce which makes our life difficult online. It's the people themselves causes the problem. That is a non-technical problem, but that is a problem of the commercial vendors try to amplify because they want to take you online and have you engage, and don't go to bed, stay in the internet and watch the heated arguments and watch the adverts. So, that's about, I showed this last year already, that is about how to design a network, a social network. We have centralized, that is what the commercial do, because it's easy to fund, it's also easier, a bit easier to develop, and it has a lot of disadvantages. Then we have federated, like Mastodon, Diaspora, which don't have this business model problems to take you captive, but their business model doesn't give much money out. And then peer-to-peer, in my opinion, has the least problems from this control your own things, but you are full responsible of your node. You don't get censorship, so that means you get all the hate speech, or what you consider as hate speech, because it violates your opinion and your belief. Maybe for the other side, it's not hate speech, it's just defending their belief. You don't know, but you don't like what they say, and they don't like what you say, so you are responsible to create a peaceful environment, good discussion, healthy discussion yourself, which is difficult. And you're also responsible that no illegal things happen on your node, which might cause some police interaction, but when the police doesn't see you, don't know if that is much of a problem for you, but it's for society might be a problem if too many things that are illegal for good reasons happen on this network. So what is Net2O? Down is a link to my video on the 31.3c, where I went from 2 to 5 mostly, with a bit of 6. So that is the starting point if you are interested in technical details. So that is the overlay network based on UDP. UDP is layer 1, is just a physical layer for Net2O using the current internet, making sure you can pass through net address translated devices and can route from anywhere to anywhere without, even when you are in a sort of captive environment, have not so much freedom, not so much options to route. And peer-to-peer is a bit difficult, particularly in IPv4, because we don't have enough addresses, so all the traffic is net address translated somewhere. So how do I implement Net2O social networks? What is the components? So I decided for texts to format them in Markdown. Markdown is pretty popular, and a lot of people know it already. Markdown has no very strict specifications, so you can have slight modifications here and there. So not Markdown is not equal Markdown, but mostly the same. Images, I decided for very simple to decode images like JPEG and PNG, where you don't have so much vulnerabilities. Movies that unfortunately cannot be done very simple, so the container format should be something like MKV or WebM is a subset of MKV, and inside like VP9 or AV1. Then comes the timeline. I have chat logs in the chat, and this chat logs is a pretty universal structure. It's just one log is an entry and contains links to other things. So the chat log is for every data structure which has time discrete events. It's the master of this data structure. You can take other things out, like the links, like objects identified by hashes, but the timeline in your social network essentially is a chat log. Posting then is a distributed version control project, and a distributed version control project itself is another chat log, because every commit is a message in that system, and a patch set, of course, or a snapshot. And a snapshot contains everything, a patch set just contains the differences. that helps to overcome these problems, how to edit something that is distributed peer-to-peer, because it's essentially it's a write-only thing. You can only write new messages out. You cannot really edit. So you can send out new things. You cannot easily recall them. But when you send out a patch, it means I edit this file. So the other side knows I have to apply this change. And that allows you to edit postings after the fact. And reshare is just take a DBCS project from one timeline to another and post it there as message. And a comment is similar to GitHub pull request. You create a fork of the project, you add your own comment, you try to push it back to the original owner, and depending if there is automatic permission for you to post or if that person has said to moderate you, the pull request gets in immediately or after that person checks if your pull request is okay and accepts it. That allows you not only to comment, that allows you also to edit the original message if there's permission for that. So you can use that wiki style where you edit the same document, or you can use it Facebook style where you add a comment. That is, it's just technology. This is all below the user interface. And likes is just the direct chat log messages, and of course it means you can send several likes or dislikes. The last one counts. So last year I gave a talk on what I wanted to do. That was this first finish the bulk importer for Google Plus, because Google Plus is now dead. That is, all you can do with Google Plus is take it somewhere else. And that is a good motivation, because actually if you have a living network, the motivation to take it somewhere else is always, yeah, but it already works. Google Plus doesn't work. So there's a motivation to take it out and to be still able to read your own Google Plus postings so it's not lost. And I figured also out I like to write a Twitter importer, because Twitter looks simple. It's a very short messages, just 280 characters, very few elements. You have hashtags, you have persons you can refer to, you have URLs, and you have images. That is not difficult. But the difficult thing about Twitter is that it's usually ping pong, you communicate with somebody else, and if you do a takeout, you have only your own stuff. You don't have the replies of the other people. So the takeout in Twitter is mostly useless, because if you have a thread of communication you want to represent in your decentralized network, you don't get it. Twitter fortunately has an API, so what I want to do is use that API to take out the actual things that reply to you. And that is more work than just import the takeout. What was easy was to display the avatars, the markdown renderer. Yeah, took some time. It's just take the markdown, use my -2 UI to render it. Album viewer completed recently, but I don't have got stuck with was the movie player on Linux, because I wanted to use the GStreamer interface, and this, I want it to render into an OpenGL texture. Just simple render in an OpenGL texture, and it always opens me a window. I don't want a window. I have a window. I didn't figure out how to disable that. But otherwise, it would not be so difficult. The key handover with the temporary key pair, every posting you get from another person when you do an importer needs a key, because the chat message is signed by a key. This is not the real key of the real person, because in Google Plus or in Twitter, they don't have keys. They just have accounts. They don't have Net2O keys. They don't have, there's no authentication on these messages. You have to believe Google or Twitter or Facebook that what these people wrote really is from these people. You have to trust the platform. There's no inherent trust. In a peer-to-peer network, you cannot trust the platform. Definitely not. It's peer-to-peer. Everybody can do anything. You have to trust the encryption. You have to trust the cryptography. So everybody needs a key. The key handover means when you have talked to some people on Google Plus and both of them imported their Google Plus data or Twitter data, and you now share the keys and hand over these temporary keys, make them invalid, and replace that by the real key. I've not done that yet. It's not so important at the moment. That Mark imported keys as not trustworthy was easy and very quickly to done. So I have now some hands on. So when you start the Net2O GUI, you get this cute netty. You can enter your password, and then you get your list of imported data that is already imported from Google Plus, my account. For example, here I have a lot of photos. This is what I want to change in style. That is just the chat log now. The chat log is not completely appropriate here as display. Its data structure is perfect. The display style should go on this side, should maybe have a thumbnail for every posting that has a photo. And it's not looking so nice, but what we can see when we go in is it looks not exactly like Google Plus, but you see a lot of photos. And you can click on the photos, see the details, and scroll between the photos. These are photos I took in my HDR phase of photography, so they are all done with the HDR. And in Changsha Chair, a wonderful place in China. So the album viewer works, and that means you can import your photo section and watch them. You can also take your things about political discussion here, for example. One of those typical discussion I had about the BND law. So we have comments there. And this is just Markdown rendered. And all the comments are also Markdown rendered and have the avatars of these people displaying. So what works now is looking at what you did. What is missing now yet is that you create new postings and create new comments. That means add an editor. It's just work, it's grunt work. It's not a difficult thing. And go back, because there were more challenges coming up. One challenge came up last year, just before the presentations, because the hackers said, oh, it's too bright, it's way too bright, because it looked like this. We want a night mode, so. Yeah, now we have colored teams. You can switch between day and night mode. And you could have more colored teams if you want, have a color team with bright colors or a color team with dull colors for people who say, I'm from the autistic spectrum, don't show me bright colors. I'm epileptic, please, black and white only. Then what I figured out is some JPEGs actually don't have thumbnails in it from cameras. I used to have cameras where everything had a thumbnail, and I used the thumbnail all the time. And now my Galaxy Note 8 sometimes adds a thumbnail, but it's unreliable. There's a library from the Enlightenment project which can open JPEGs very quickly if you specify that you only want a very small portion of it. And I need to add that if there's no thumbnail, I need to use this, because if you load in one of these image albums with 200, 300 pictures, you want to load them in quickly. And that means thumbnails only. One picture large, the rest thumbnails. Then that was a protocol challenge. That is, what is the, who has what? I have a detail about this, because each object is somewhere in the peer-to-peer network. You need to get it, and you need only get it when you have the right to get it, when you have the right to know it. It's not something the entire world should know that is out there and can get. So the original plan was something like, use it like the BitTorrent network, where for DHT, where every object is globally visible, but that's not a good idea. And my original solution was to encrypt these hashes and provide the key to that. But it still has the same problem. If you have a query, I want this encrypted hash, you don't know what it is, but you know the same people want the same thing. You don't know what it is, but you know it's the same thing and the same people want it. That already reveals information about who is networked, and maybe you can figure out how to get in. So another possible solution would be onion routing within the DHT. So you make the query to one node of the DHT and go through an onion routing to the DHT node who answers it. That is a solution. It's complex and slow. So I don't want it, and that's a shortcut, because the people who talk with you have their chat log structure shared with you, already know who has what, because they shared part of it before. So you can put that who has what within the chat log structure, synchronize with the chat log, and then you can ask the people connected to you, please send me this file, send me this patch set. Who means device.pubkey? Unlike WhatsApp and other protocols out there now, you have multi-device ability, so you need to specify on which device is this file, and PubKey is the owner of this device. Then you can connect to this device, ask for this object, and it does not go outside this channel, this closed group you are talking with. So what the next thing was, comfortable ID cloning. If you have multi-devices, you want to copy your ID from one device to the other. And that has to be very simple for the normal user. And so you need authorized remote file access. Fortunately, we have a protocol for that, it's Net2O, but you need to establish the authorization. You don't have an authorized key. So you first scan one of these color QR codes, send an invitation packet back that shows you have actually scanned this color QR code and are in proximity to the device. You get a confirmation by a different color QR, and then you can do a zero knowledge proof of, I have the password you choose to protect the secret key. So you are really the same person. It's not somebody wanting to steal your device, your ID. And then you have a proof of authority, and then you can send over the keys with that Net2O connection. That is not completely finished now. that is from here, the last two steps is still missing. There's ETF task group who talks about general ideas how to do this, comes from the people in Switzerland doing that for email, because for email you already have this multiple device solution for a long time, and you need to make easy ways to hand over your keys between your devices in a secure way. So then there's the permissions, because now when you talk to people in the chat room, you may choose different models how to moderate. Do I have something on the permissions? No. Whom do you allow to post automatically without moderation? Who do you want to moderate? And who do you want to just read only your blog? Some people like to have read only blogs, like Fefe, for example. This makes perfectly sense to define roles and permissions. And that wasn't in there, so that needs to be done. The likes, really only the last one needs to count, otherwise one person can send 1,000 likes. Does not make much sense. Before I had one-to-one chats, which were closed, and group chats, which were open to everybody who found the chat ID. Now I added closed group chat. That is necessary if you want to kick out somebody. They already know the chat ID. You don't want to move that over to a new chat ID, lose everybody in the process. You just want to kick out. So you have a session key inside the chat which you share, and if the person does not figure out how to get the session key because they can't open the session key, they don't have the necessary private key, secret key, they are out, and they can be get in again. So you can say, okay, we ban you for 10 minutes, and after 10 minutes we invite you in back if you calm down, and then you can continue. And you need permissions for moderator. Normally only yourself can cancel messages, but if you have a heated discussion, the moderator may say, oh, I want to cancel this. It's not legal speech in our country, or it's insulting persons, it's better to delete it. That is within the group. That is not from outside imposed. It makes a lot of sense. If you have heated discussion, you don't want to have everything. You want to close lockdown groups at some time, or you want to remove persons, or you want to remove only some postings of them. And then there's the metadata, the shareable list of collection you have. What you saw in my demonstration is at the moment not shareable. You need to know that. But I want to make use of this chat log structure there too, so you can synchronize it, share it. And the last one, when you are roaming, when you are in different countries, have a Wi-Fi in the hotel or somewhere, you often encounter this port 53 UDP and 8443 TCP only networks. You cannot do anything else than the web. And the DNS is just going to the local resolver. So you cannot use DNS to route. You can only use HTTP. So my idea is to use something like WebSockets for this, have a server you can connect with WebSockets, and on the client, on the other side, it just pushes out the UDP packets. This needs to be done. I think it's not much work, because NetSockets, you have libraries for that. Do I have something for this? Yeah, that here. One problematic part here is that the adversary, like the Great Firewall of China, tests this kind of connections. They do this for the Tor project, so if you make a connection with the Tor from inside China, the Great Firewall also tries to open a Tor protocol link to the same server, and if they get one, then they close down the entire server. So you maybe can open Tor for half a minute, and then the backlog of the server probing all these things also opened it, and then this server, this Tor entry node is blocked forever. And it's on a dynamic IP address, it means for one day, but this is means from China is useless. So add authorization, and we need single packet authorization. It's not hip, because if the hop comes back, it's already an answer where you see they answer to this protocol. You can send one packet out, and it needs to contain everything for the authorization, and it needs to need to make sure it's not revealing anything for the attacker. It does not reveal what kind of protocol it is. It does not reveal any identity of you or the other side. So it's just a random garbage sent out, and some random garbage comes in, and then it goes. And if they try to open it, they will fail because they don't have the authorization for it. They don't have a key known to this point. So that needs a change in the Net2O connection setup, because I need a single package authorization. Now I do the authorization in a three-way handshake. It's easier to do, but it's also possible to do it with a single handshake. So this gives another improvement, because with the net traversal I have now a five-way handshake. I make three-way handshake over the DHT route. Some DHT forwards my packets, and then I open up the net traversal. And so I could get one round for the authorization, and in the back already start opening up the net traversal. It gives me one RTD less. It's not very important for low latency networks, but if you are far apart on the world, then it helps. Then you realize that. That's what I'm now working on also. That helps for this closed lockdown networks. Last year in China, I was there in August, and on August 1st, the entire network of China Mobile switched to IPv6, open up IPv6. And what they did at the same time is they changed their Great Firewall to this lockdown policy, probably because they don't have good code for targeted filtering in place for IPv6. They have for IPv4, they don't need this strict lockdown, but they don't have for IPv6. It's all new, so they just open the web, and it's limited pretty much. And you don't see that when you go on Google an IPv6 deployment, you don't see any of those 700 million devices that have now IPv6. You don't see any. They don't reach Google. It's not that they are not there. It's just they don't reach Google. Google doesn't know anything about that. So anything else? Yeah, that was it. So there are some non-technical problems with Net2O. That is, when you have a lot of contacts in the Google Plus, Twitter, blah world, you need to get them over to Net2O. You need to encourage them to install Net2O. It needs to work stable. It needs to be complete. It needs to be user-friendly. Otherwise, they don't come. Your contacts will not come when it's difficult. The second problem is how to make a social network a nice place. We have these problems in the existing social networks. They are not nice places. because the ad-based business model makes sure they don't become nice. They shouldn't become nice. The only nice thing you should see there is the adverts, the ones you make you happy. So you buy the products. The other things should not make you happy. They should engage you and look at more adverts. And then there are some funding. I want funding. And I have thought about using this cryptocurrency I started developing 2 years ago, but the cryptocurrency funding business is very toxic. You get a lot of money, but you get these toxic idiots which want to get rich quickly, and the scammers, and that is a conflict of ethics for me. So getting funded is one thing, but getting a toxic community of scammers and they manipulate the currency like Bitcoin and have this Tether thing, which is very, very much a fraud. And I don't want to have this on my side. So I'm looking for other ways to fund things. I want to make an app that is sold on the App Store, and it will turn out. I think it's not, if there's a somehow polished product, you can get enough money to sustain it, because it's not, I don't need the billions Facebook needs to operate these things. I'm only doing the software development. Facebook has a lot of servers. But you have to think about the resources you have in the cloud. You have to duplicate a lot of data. You have to duplicate a lot of processing. If you communicate peer-to-peer, you have your photos on your own device, anyhow. But if you want to use a cloud service to communicate, you have to make copies of them. They have to keep this data as well. And they have to use some delivery content delivery network, so they duplicate several times. It's just not one copy. It's not enough, especially if you share a lot to many people. In the peer-to-peer network, if you share a lot, then the copy of your data is out there already a lot of times. Everybody you got it can share it again. But in the centralized thing, you need these copies done in the CDNs of the providers, and it wastes a lot of energy there, and a lot of hardware resources go in just to share some photos, and it's not free of charge. The value of one Facebook user, I think, is in the several hundred dollar range. That is the value from you buying the useless things they want you to buy by the ads. And that is how they fund their business. So you really are an expensive product. It's not cheap. You have to think about this. So last page is, this time I only give the starting point. And these two color QR codes, I've tried with the night mode, but the cameras have problems with the white balance. Here, the day mode has a big white rectangle. So if you scan it with the Net2O app, this one is a blimp. If you're not perspective correction, then it's difficult, but if you're straight heading it, it's just very easy. It's not even focusing it, and then it scans it. This one is difficult because there's yellow, and the white balancer says, this is probably white. But when it's probably white, it's wrong. It cannot scan correctly. So you need the white balancing things. The night mode sometimes works, maybe with a projector. When you still have enough gray in the background, it can work, but this one is very reliable, so the day mode. And the color QRs are the means for people with mobile phones to quickly share their identities and connect to each other. people don't like to enter cryptic things, no matter what how you present them, but they are very happy to scan QR codes. That is solving the Sucos triangle, because you have to, when you get your contacts, you need a human meaningful name and figure out how that is connected to this cryptographic key. But if you can scan the key directly, you don't need that. So that's my talk. And if there are questions, you can ask me now or later at the Forstgesellschaft booth.
Thanks so much, Bernd. If you have any questions, you can raise your hand now and I will come to you with a microphone. And I can also come to the signal angel if he has any questions. Okay, not yet. So, and also after the talk, you can of course approach him directly.
Maybe I'm not sure if it's a really relevant question, but you said we cost 100. Some people cost 100 euro for Facebook. Is that per? What is the time unit? Like, it's an ongoing cost, so is it 100 euro per year or something like that? Do you have more precision on the number?
What I'm planning. You mean the price for the app? The price for the app will be in the low euro rate, because you don't want to... If I sell 1 million apps for 2 or 3 euros, the funding is completely done. I don't need more. I just need to sell 1 million apps or so. And compared to how many users you get for WhatsApp or WeChat or Telegram, 1 million is little. I don't even need to have everybody to pay it. I can make this voluntarily. I can give out a free app, and if you want to donate, you buy the silver or the gold app. And when you go to Google Store, you need to do the funding via their payment system. They don't like any other methods. They want their 30% share, and because they do a lot of this for this infrastructure, it's okay for me. Give them 30%. It's not a big deal. When you are an institutional investor, you can give me some 10,000 euro. That is completely different. But if you're a private person, I don't want to take a lot of money from you.
One more question in the back here.
Yeah, hi. You mentioned CDNs, content delivery. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you have some sort of multicast in Net2O. We're doing so if I send a message to a friend and then I forward that message to another friend, but they have a closer link, is it going to be shared from the first person I shared it to?
That is what the peer-to-peer network comes in. When you share something with your friend, you send them your data, your IHFs, and they copy your objects and forward that they also have it to their friends. So the friends now can choose where to download from their friends, from you. They have more options. So a peer-to-peer network is a content delivery network by nature. That is what it's supposed to be. The content delivery networks actually internally work like peer-to-peer networks. They have to use the same technology. They just don't give the end user the freedom to be part of this peer-to-peer network. They don't want you to be part of the network. You are the product. You are not part of the community.
Okay. Thank you so much, Bernd, for your talk. That was very interesting, and there were more questions coming up, I think, directly afterwards in private to find out more about it. Thank you very much for presenting that at Open Infrastructure Orbit at Congress. Thank you.